Hi there. Thank you all for your patience as we're waiting to get more people signed in. I want to welcome you to our training on Section 504, Special Education, What's the Difference? My name is Charlie Michel, and I'll be the presenter for this training. My co-host today will be Wallace Johnson from Family Suffering Families of Southwest Louisiana. This training is going to cover some of the basic differences between Section 504 and IDEA, or Special Education. Now, in order to continue to receive funding to provide these free trainings, I'm going to ask that you complete an evaluation at the end. The evaluation results help us to improve trainings and demonstrate the need for continued funding to provide these types of trainings to our community free of charge. You'll be prompted again at the end of the presentation to complete the evaluation, and it should take you no more than 2 minutes to complete. Everyone completing an evaluation and making a request will receive a copy of this PowerPoint and a certificate of attendance. If at any time you lose audio, you can always call in using the phone number that you got when you got your invitation after you registered. And you have gotten this through your email. And participants are encouraged to submit questions in the chat box or wait until the end for Q&A time, question and answer time. Either way is fine. We'll address them as they come up in the chat box or at the end for questions and answers. And I do like questions because it does help to make me realize that some things that we've talked have been stimulating your thought processes and that you want a little bit more clarification. That's a good thing. Now, BioLand Families Helping Families and Families Helping Families of Southwest Louisiana provide dozens of webinars and in-person trainings like this on special education and other disability-related topics every year. So we invite you to check out our calendar of events at www.blfhf.org or at www.fhfswla.org on a regular basis and register for any upcoming trainings that might be of interest to you. We also encourage you to request specific trainings that are currently not being offered. Chances are, if you're interested in a topic, someone else is too. And I'm going to turn this over to Wallace Johnson, our co-host. Wallace, take her away.
Good morning, everyone. And thank you, Dr. Trailer, for inviting us to take part in this webinar with you. I'm a special education advocate here at Families Helping Families, and we work just like the Bayou Land Families Helping Family Center. We do some a lot same or similar things. And I'm here today to talk to you about the Louisiana Council's Advocacy Network, LACAN. It's a statewide grassroots advocacy network, and its purpose is to link lawmakers, individuals with disabilities, and family members to make positive changes in systems serving people with disability. LACAN advocates for policies and systems that support inclusion everywhere where people learn, work, live, and play. LACAN also advocates for systems that support children and adults with disabilities to live in their own homes and be fully included and participating members of their local schools and community. LACAN leaders provide a connection with a regional team of advocates to provide information on proposed policy changes and how these changes may affect you and others, and provide training and skills to effectively advocate for systems change and support you to link you with policymakers. And in a few minutes, I'm going to put the link to the LACAN website in the chat. And some of the initiatives that they're working on right now is they're working on trying to get our state to eliminate the waiting list for the flexible family fund for families that use that. We are hoping that one day that'll end and there'll be no waiting list. So with your advocacy efforts through the CAN might help us to get our policymakers and legislatures to work on that or help or change that. Another thing is they're looking into increasing the night rate for the providers that do the support staff at night, to increase that night rate for the workers, the direct support staff that work at night. And then they're working on the funding for the Families Helping Families Resource Centers. So if you're interested in, contacting your legislatures about those issues, You can go to www.lacanadvocates.org or contact your local family center and ask them to be connected to the Lacan leader, and then they can help you with that. It's easy to get alerts from Lacan. All you got to do is either check with your Lacan leader or get with them about it, or you can go to the website and sign up. Again, it's www.lacanadvocates.org. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Dr. Charlie.
Thanks, Wallace. That was very informative. You said some stuff I had forgotten about. Good job. Thank you. Okay, get to the next one. All right. As we start this, every training that we do, especially when it has to do with laws like special ed and 504, I have to tell you that I'm not a lawyer. I do these presentations because I have a lot of experience with working with the law in the school system. But I am not a lawyer. None of this can be construed as legal advice. If I answer a question, it's going to be in the context of what I think might perhaps be the rule based on this. I've got a pretty good track record with it, but remember, if you have a legal question, I'll give you a response to what I think it is, but always consult an attorney before you do anything else. All right, today's objectives, by the end of today, I'm hoping our workshop will help you better understand the differences between Section 504 and Special Education Services, and that you'll have a better understanding of the process used to determine the eligibility for each, because it is vastly different. We will discuss how IEP meetings and 504 meetings are used to determine which services are appropriate and how your child will be able to access these services. Section 504 plans are also called accommodation plans, or IAPs, individual accommodation plans, and the individual education plans, which we call IEPs for special ed, or they have many differences, just as do the laws that guide their development. It's important that you know the differences in order to determine how these plans can assist your child in school through the use of accommodations and other supports and services, because again, there are many, many differences. And lastly, our goal is that you will determine whether one is better than the other. Okay, so now let's get to the meat and potatoes of today's presentation. A little history of special education. In 1975, Public Law 94-142, which was called at the time the Education for All Handicapped Children Act, and special ed, we love a good acronym, so this was the EHA. That law was passed in 1975. This law recognized and addressed the fact that more than half of the school-aged children with disabilities in the USA were not receiving an education, and that those who were attending schools were often placed in settings apart from their peers who had no disabilities. Just as importantly, the educational needs of these children with disabilities were often being overlooked. Then in 1990, 15 years later, Public Law 101-476 was passed and was later called the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA, as everybody knows it today. This law added traumatic brain injury and autism to the list of identified disabilities and emphasized that students with disabilities must have equal access to the same curriculum as their peers with no disabilities. And we'll talk in a minute about the disability list for IDEA. Then in 2004, Congress amended the IDEA by calling for early intervention for students, greater accountability and improved educational outcomes, and raised the standards for instructors who teach special education classes. It also required states to demand that local school districts shift up to 15% of their special education funds toward general education if it were determined that a disproportionate number of students from minority groups were placed in a special education for reasons other than disability. And just to make that a little cleaner, every school district receives federal dollars to pay for special education services. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But if you have an inordinate number of children from one ethnic group or one gender or anything that are identified as special ed, then say like if you have African-Americans who are identified as mildly intellectually disabled or with emotional disturbances, those are two of the big ones. If you have more kids in those categories being identified for those disabilities than you would have, say, white children doing that, then 15% of those special ed monies have to go toward addressing the differences and the needs of those children in that over-identified class. Now that was special ed. Now a little bit of history about 504. Section 504 of the Vocational Rehabilitation Act of 1973 was passed to ensure that all people have equal access to buildings and opportunities, regardless of their disabilities. When it was first passed, it was geared mostly toward access to federal buildings, your post offices, your Social Security office, those things that people need to get access to. But as time went on, people with disabilities and their families wondered why equal access couldn't be extended past federal buildings. So through their advocacy work and lobbying, in 1990, the Americans with Disabilities Act, or ADA as it's called, was passed. The ADA is a civil rights law that prohibits discrimination based on a person's disability. Then in 2008, the ADA Amendments Act of 2008 was passed. It was an act of Congress and became effective January 1st, 2009. And this law amended the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990, as well as other disability non-discrimination laws at the federal level of the United States. This act emphasized that the definition of disability should be construed in favor of a broad coverage of individuals to the maximum extent permitted by the terms of the ADA and generally shall not require extensive analysis. We're going to talk about that in English terms later on when we're comparing the way that eligibility is determined with special education and 504. And this, the act makes important changes to the definition of the term disability by rejecting the holdings in several Supreme Court decisions at the time and portions of the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission's ADA regulations. The effect of these changes is to make it easier for an individual seeking protection under the ADA to establish that he or she has a disability within the meaning of the ADA. And we'll talk about that comparison between eligibility with 504 and eligibility for special ed. And this is important because it sets up one of the fundamental differences between the identification of a disability under Section 504 and special education. Now, while special education is a federal law, each state must produce guidelines and regulations to ensure that the law is passed. In Louisiana, many of these regulations are contained within the Board of Secondary and Elementary Education Bulletin 1508. And those of you, Board of Secondary and Elementary Education is called BESE. That's why you'll often hear students who receive special education services as special ed students or as 1508 students, because Bulletin 1508 has all the list of things that are required in order to meet the eligibility. Professionals often use these terms interchangeably. Unfortunately, that's part of the educational jargon. So if someone refers to your child as 1508 or special ed or whatever, and you don't know exactly what that means, just ask them, like anything else. If they say something you don't understand, an acronym, a term, ask, because it's important that you have the right to meaningfully participate. Now, when IDEA was originally passed, it was intended to fund about 40% of the costs for local school systems to provide these services. The remainder of the cost to provide these services would be borne by the local school systems using local and state funds. Since the beginning, the actual funding of these services has never actually surpassed 20% and often falls short of even that more. However, IDEA is clear in its mandate that any lack of funding cannot be used as an excuse for not providing services identified as a result of the IEP team discussions and decisions. And that's whether federal government funds it or not. Federal law is that the services must be provided. So if a school system says they don't have the money to do something, probe deeper. If they don't have the money for an appropriate activity, that would be a violation of law. But if they don't have the money for something that goes beyond appropriate, that would be a violation. Now the discussion for funding of 504 is going to be much more brief, because there just isn't any. All costs to support Section 504 services are borne by the local school system. There are no federal dollars that come to the school system. There are no state dollars that come to the school system specifically for supporting Section 504. However, the lack of funding does not provide the school system with an excuse not to provide the services and supports required for a student in order for him or her to level the playing field with the peers who have no disability. In that respect, 504 and special ed are exactly the same. With or without funding, you must provide the services. So that there is no funding for 504, that's a huge difference, as we said. But remember, both are in agreement that lack of funding cannot limit the education services needed program to a child with a disability through the IEP or IAP meeting process. Now, in order to determine eligibility for special education services, an evaluation must be conducted. But before such an evaluation is able to take place, either the parent, the school, or the student must express in writing that there's a concern. Those concerns have been brought to the school building level committee, of which the parent is a member, for discussion. Now, the SPLC, or the school building level committee, is charged with the responsibility of reviewing student data when a concern has been noted. It is the SPLC, of which the parent is a member, that can decide to refer a student for evaluation, provide interventions and monitor student progress, or just continue monitoring student performance and reconvene at a later date to discuss progress or lack of progress. Now, typically, Pupil Appraisal Center, or PAC, personnel will be in attendance at an SPLC meeting when discussing parental concerns and a parent's desire to have their child evaluated. The PAC representative can explain the evaluation process to the parent and provide the necessary documents for parents to sign in order for such an evaluation to begin. It is important to know that once the discussions of the evaluation have begun, the student is protected under IDEA in the event of any disciplinary event that may take place. However, it is equally important to know that should any disciplinary event take place before the evaluation request was made, the student will enjoy no such protections. Now, once the evaluation is complete, the SDLC will reconvene with the parent to discuss the findings. It is during this meeting that the eligibility determination is made. If the student is determined to be eligible for services under IDEA, an initial IEP meeting would be scheduled to discuss which supports and services would be appropriate for your child in order to address the concerns you stated upon your request for an evaluation. Now, following this initial IEP meeting, at least one IEP meeting must be conducted annually to review your child's progress and to make necessary changes based on the data presented during those meetings. However, you should know either the school personnel or the parents have the right to call for an IEP meeting anytime it is felt that FAPE is not being provided, that the student's progress indicates a need for changes to the supports or services on the IEP, or that the terms of the IEP just aren't being implemented. The term FAPE we talked about just a second ago means free appropriate public education. And if you see, it comes from the first letter of each of those four words, and that is written in the law. It is very clearly described. Now, to be appropriate, because remember, that's one of the key words in there, free and appropriate. To be appropriate, education programs for students with disabilities must be designed to meet their individual needs to the same extent that the needs of non-disabled students are met. An appropriate education may include regular or special education and related services and aids to accommodate the unique needs of the individual with disabilities. One way to ensure that programs meet individual needs is through the development of an individual education program, or IEP, or if the child is eligible for 504, through a 504 plan for each student with a disability. In both of these, IAP and IEP, the I is to individualize, and that is the crux of programming. It must be individualized to the student. So IEPs are required for students participating in the special ed programs of recipients of funding under the IDEA. 504 plans, or IAPs, are required for students who meet the definition of a disability through the Section 504 laws and regulations. The quality of education services provided to these students with disabilities must equal the quality of services provided to non-disabled students. Teachers of students with disabilities must be trained in the instruction of individuals with disabilities. Facilities must be comparable, and appropriate materials and equipment must be available. Students with disabilities may not be excluded from participating in non-academic services and extracurricular activities based on the disability. Persons with disabilities must be provided an opportunity to participate in non-academic services that is equal to those provided to persons without disabilities. These services may include physical education, recreational athletics, transportation, health services, recreational activities, special interest groups or clubs sponsored by the school, and referrals to agencies that provide assistance to persons with disabilities and the employment of students. And one of the things that I didn't put on this list that I need to, one of the things that's critical, a lot of times parents of children with disabilities, they attend a school that provides before school care or after school care. Frequently, those children are denied access to it because it would require more employees to be hired. Or they'll hire the employees, but the parent has to pay a different amount, a greater amount than people of children without disabilities. They cannot do that. If it is open to all students, it is open to all students, and a child with a disability cannot be assessed a greater fee than a child without a disability. That is part of the law as well. Now, we talked earlier about, at one point, the two categories were added, traumatic brain injury and something else. I can't remember what it was. But I wanted to identify the 13 physical or mental impairments which constitute a disability should any of these impairments substantially limit access to the student's educational opportunities. But in addition to the presence of a disability, in order for a student to be determined eligible for special education services under the IDEA, the evaluation must also conclude that in order to have equal access to educational opportunities and the general education curriculum as their peers who don't have a disability, specialized instruction and our support services are required. In the absence of the need for specialized instruction and our support services, the student cannot be determined eligible for special education classification under the IDEA. This eligibility in many states can be determined regarding concerns in children between the ages of 3 and 21 years of age. But in Louisiana, we're fortunate because we have the Early Steps program, which provides intervention to eligible students from birth until the age of 3. Upon the child reaching his or her third birthday, if eligibility continues, the local school system begins to provide those supports and services. What are these 13 disabilities that are identified in IDEA? They are autism, deafblindness, deafness, emotional disturbance, hearing impairment, intellectual disability, multiple disabilities, orthopedic impairment, other health impairment, including ADHD frequently, specific learning disability, speech or language impairment, traumatic brain injury, and visual impairment, including blindness. Now, it's important to look at that list and remember, because we're talking about 504, we're going to notice a big difference in that. Now, you see the 13 on the list that are listed in IDEA. But there's also a 14th disability category that's allowed if school districts choose to use it. And that's why it's not on this list, because it is at the discretion of each individual school system. If a child is experiencing developmental delays, as defined by the state and as measured by appropriate diagnostic instruments and procedures, in one or more of the following areas: physical development, cognitive development, communication development, social or emotional development, or adaptive development, and who, because of those delays, need special education and related services, the child may be determined eligible for special education services with the classification of developmental delay. Now, it's true. This is one reason why the school, not all school districts use it, because it's critical that you understand that when a child turns 9 years old, if he or she still doesn't meet the criteria for one of those 13 recognized disabilities you see on your screen that's listed in the IDEA, that child will no longer be eligible for special education supports and services. So what that means is the child is receiving supports under developmental delay for 9 years. But they don't meet the specific criteria for autism or for learning disabled or for deafness or blindness or any of those things. But once they turn 9, if they still don't meet the specific criteria for one of those 13 disabilities, the child is no longer eligible for special ed services. So now you have a child in third grade, usually, maybe fourth, maybe second, who is no longer eligible for special education supports. They've been receiving these supports all of their lives up to this point, And now they can't get it because by law, they can't be identified as qualified under special education. That is a huge problem. And that is one of the reasons why a lot of school districts don't use it. And also another reason some school districts don't use it is because there's a lot of research that supports that developmental delay with those areas that we talked about is a category that identifies poverty more than it does a disability. Like, and by that, what I mean is, you know, a lot of people take their kids to restaurants, take their kids to the movies, take their kids to the grocery stores with them. People of poverty sometimes don't have the opportunities to do that. Either they're working two or three jobs, it's a single parent, they don't have the money to be able to do what they need to do. So the kids don't have the opportunities to be able to engage in those activities that people with a little bit more means are able to do. That lack of exposure creates a deficit in some of those areas we talked about. That's not a disability, that's just lack of exposure. So one of the problems is that this developmental delay criteria frequently identifies poverty rather than disability. So the issue is to deal with the poverty, address that as one of the key problems. And now, while this doesn't happen often, sometimes parents might disagree with the findings of the evaluation team for any number of reasons. So what is your recourse when this happens? Federal law provides parents the right to request an independent education evaluation, or IEE, free of charge to the parent anytime they disagree with the school district's evaluation. A request is all that's necessary. You don't have to provide a reason. However, I always encourage transparency. I encourage you to explain your reason or reasons to the school system because there might be a simple explanation that will help you better understand the findings. But as I said, the law says you don't have to provide such a reason or engage in such a discussion if that is your preference. Once you make the request for an IEE, the school system will give you some options as to who might be able to conduct this evaluation for you. While you are entitled to this evaluation free of charge, the school district also has the right to set reasonable limits to the costs incurred. The school district's limits should be provided to you in writing at the same time as they give you the list of evaluation agencies. So if you want to engage an evaluation agency other than one on the list provided you, you certainly may do so, but costs which surpass those allowed by the school district may have to be borne by you. And that's a conversation you can have with the school system. Whichever agency you choose, however, there are certain evaluation requirements which must be met. And if they're not met, the school system is not obligated to pay for that evaluation. The school system should let the evaluating agency know where they can find these requirements, and that would be in Louisiana Bessie Bulletin 1508. And once this initial conversation is had, though, your local school district will have no further discussions with the evaluating agency until they have completed the evaluation process. And this is to ensure that the evaluation is truly independent and there's not even an appearance of interference from the local school district or collaboration between the local school district and the independent evaluator. Because the purpose of it is to get a second opinion, not a repeat of the first opinion based on the first school district's choices. Now, once this independent evaluation is complete, an IEP team meeting must be convened in which the school system is obligated by law to consider the findings and content of the IEE. But there is no mandate that the school system accept the findings and all recommendations of the IEE, which means you can get the IEE, it costs you nothing, you give it to the school system, they have the right to accept the entire evaluation and say, okay, we agree with this finding, so we're going to move forward with this. Or they can say, we don't agree with this at all, we're not going to accept any of it. Or they can say, while we don't agree with parts of this, we do agree with this, this, this. But they can accept it all, reject it all, or accept and reject parts of it. All right, that was 1508, special ed, IDEA eligibility. So let's talk a little bit about the eligibility process and requirements for 504. The role of the SPLC is the same when Section 504 eligibility is being considered. The committee discusses the concerns and reviews the data to decide if evaluation is warranted or if intervention should be implemented or if a wait and see approach is in order. But remember, even if the SPLC doesn't think an evaluation is warranted at this time, by virtue of your request, they must conduct one unless you decide to hold off on your request. So if they convince you that, okay, we see your concerns, but we think if we do these interventions that your child will do better, so let's do that, and then we'll determine, we'll come back in 6 weeks, let's say, look at the data, and we can decide if we want to do an evaluation at that point. They have the right to ask you to do that. You don't have the legal obligation to accept that. You can say in that instance, you can say, well, I appreciate that you want to do those interventions, and I would like you to do those, but I want you to conduct the evaluation at the same time. And they not only can they do that, they're obligated by law to do that if need be. So the SDLC nor any person in the school or district can override your right to an evaluation once you put the request in writing. Now, if a Section 504 evaluation is being considered, there may not always be a PAC representative present. However, if there is one, their function will be the same, to explain the evaluation process and obtain your consent. However, if no PAC representative is in the meeting, these responsibilities typically fall on the school building level committee chair. Just like a student who's being considered for special education evaluation, once the discussions of evaluation have begun, the student is protected under Section 504 in the event of any disciplinary event that may take place. However, it is equally important to know that just as in the case with IDEA, should any disciplinary event that takes place before the evaluation request was made, the student will enjoy no such protections. Now, unlike IDEA, Section 504 eligibility has no age limitations. Remember, IDEA was in Louisiana, it's birth to 21. But of course, here, for purposes of today's training, we're only discussing children in pre-K to 12 educational setting. If eligibility is determined, an IAP will be a team meeting will be scheduled during which appropriate accommodations and supports will be determined. After this initial IAP meeting is conducted, review meetings should be conducted at least annually, but may be called anytime by the school or the parent if there is a concern that the student's progress is sufficient and changes to the plan may be warranted, or if there is a concern that the plan isn't being implemented properly. One of the biggest concerns that parents come to us with is that they'll ask for an IEP meeting or an IAP meeting, and they're told, well, no, it's not due until, and they give you the annual date. Well, what they're saying is true. It's due on that day, that annual date, but they have an obligation to have meetings to discuss the data anytime you feel like the child is not making adequate progress or it's not being implemented, or you have some serious concern, whether it's IAP or IEP. So if at any point you get that answer, no, we can't do that until, like we're in April now, so let's say we can't do that until next October. Well, that's not true, because to hold off on it is a disservice to the child, and it ceases to, it actually interferes with your rights as a parent. Now, before a student can be determined eligible for 504, someone has to indicate that the child has a problem, and that someone can be the child's parent, a school official, or the child himself. In order to document this, the question often arises, does the parent request have to be in writing? Well, the technical answer is it depends. It does have to be in writing, but what if the parent can't write? Does that mean that the student loses his ability to be considered for Section 504 eligibility? Absolutely not. If for any reason the parent can't put the request in writing, there's several options. School personnel need to be created. They can write the request and have the parent sign it. Or the school personnel can make the request for the evaluation on their own, because school can make a request for evaluations if they have concerns, and then they can have the parent sign that. There are many ways to get around this situation, but there is no way to get around the fact that the parent must sign the form giving permission to the school to conduct an evaluation on their child. If the parent refuses to sign it, then the school cannot initiate any evaluation process. Once written parental permission is provided, the school district has 60 school days in which to complete the evaluation. Now, so school days is critical, because if you request an evaluation today, there are not 60 school days left in this year. So the evaluation, in all likelihood, will not be finished this school year. It will be next year. So if they ask you, though, if the school says, look, there's not 60 days left, we won't have time to finish it, can we just do this? Can you make the request next year? My answer would always be no, thank you. because I want you to start it now, because the sooner you start it, the 60 days runs into next year, but it's not as deep into the next year if you start now. Let's say with 25 days of school left. When school starts in August, they only have 35 days left, school days left to do it. If they don't start it till the first day of school, then they have 60 school days left in the next school year. There's no point in putting it off. They will be off. The time stops at the time the school days end, and they resume when the school days start again. Now, unlike special education, which has a very specific definition of what constitutes a disability, the regulations in Section 504 eligibility are much broader. In order to determine eligibility for services under Section 504, three questions must be answered. The first question is, does the student have a physical or mental impairment? And if so, describe that impairment. The second question is, does the physical or mental impairment affect one or more major life activities? If so, which major life activities are affected? And the third and final question is, does the physical or mental impairment substantially limit a major life activity? Well, as you can see, the definition for disability under Section 504 is very different from the definition under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Improvement Act. Under Section 504, a person with a disability is one who has a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits a major life activity. We will discuss substantial limitation in major life activities in a few slides. Another criteria for the determination as to whether or not a person has a disability under Section 504 is that the individual has a record of such impairment or finding that the person is regarded as having such an impairment. I gotta tell you, I had a hard time wrapping my brain around regarded as having an impairment, but after much research and many discussions with attorneys, I learned that this criterion is not so much for the initial eligibility determination as it is about the anti-discrimination component of Section 504. Because remember, Section 504 is a civil rights law. So whether an individual is or is not determined to have a disability under Section 504, if another person takes action against the individual, such as bullying, physical aggression, or anything negative like that, and that negative action is because the aggressor thinks the individual has a disability, then the aggressor can be found guilty of discrimination and violation of the individual's civil rights. The key to eligibility rests within the answers to the three questions we just identified. In order to be identified as eligible for Section 504 services, the answer to all three questions must be yes. If any of them is answered no, regardless of which one, then that child cannot meet the definition of a person with a disability under Section 504. So if you recall, the first question is, does the student have a physical or mental impairment? And if so, describe that impairment. That one's pretty easy. Any diagnosis from a doctor, data from assessments administered, interviews with family members and school staff can all be used to answer this question. It's pretty much just a simple yes or no question, but it does require data to support whichever answer is determined. And that means if it's yes, data must support yes. If it's no, data must support no. The second question is, does the physical or mental impairment affect one or more major life activities? This question is also fairly straightforward. If the impairment is determined to exist, does it affect one or more major life activities? And if so, which major life activities are affected? But then this question leads to another question that's not the third question of the eligibility process. It's what are the major life activities? Because you have to know what they are in order to know if they're affected. Well, unlike special ed and IDEA, Section 504 does not list disabilities per se, but it does provide a rather lengthy list of major life activities that, if significantly impacted, might constitute a disability. Look at this list that's before you. These are some of the major life activities identified in Section 504, as well as in subsequent laws passed in order to strengthen the original intent of Section 504. These laws include the 1990 Americans with Disabilities Act and the 2008 Americans with Disabilities Act Amendments Act. But in each of these laws, it's clearly stated that this list, long as it is not all-inclusive. Some other major life activities might include disorders of the reproductive system, immune system, digestive system, bowel and bladder systems, the neurological system, the brain, respiratory and circulatory functions. And even when you add all of these to the extensive list that's already on the in the law, it's still not all inclusive. So if this long list, it's this long list coupled with the more relaxed approach to eligibility determination stated in Section 504, that makes it much simpler for a person to be eligible for Section 504 services than it is under IDEA. And that's what we talked about at the beginning. It's less structured process for eligibility for special ed, for 504. And in special ed, there's an additional component that you don't have in 504. In 504, if you meet all these requirements and still don't need support, educational supports or instruction, you can still be eligible, whereas in IDEA, you cannot be. Now, the third and final eligibility question is, does the physical or mental impairment substantially limit a major life activity? And if so, which major life activity? All right, here's another question. What exactly is substantial limitation? Well, that depends. There's no definition provided in the law, regulations, or the guidance regarding Section 504. The Section 504 committee using the evaluation data must determine whether or not there is a substantial limitation. Some of those determinations are quite clear. If a child is in a wheelchair, his or her mobility is most definitely substantially limited. But what if a child has a seizure disorder but hasn't had a seizure for 2 years? Is there a substantial limitation? That answer must be individualized to the child being discussed, and the answer may well vary from one student to another. Now, if the parent disagrees with the decision of the 504 committee about eligibility, the parent has a right to follow the due process procedures that each district must have outlined for 504. It should be noted that the courts have not to date defined substantial limitation, and in the end, it will probably be a court that will create some sort of definition. But until that happens, it will more than likely be inconsistently interpreted across the United States, and more concerning, it could be different from one district to another in the state. It can also be different from one campus to another within the same school system. So as I said earlier, in order for a child to meet the definition of a person with a disability based on 504 regulations, the answer to each of the three questions must be yes. Even one no answer, and the determination must be made that the child is not eligible for Section 504 services, regardless of which of the three questions was answered with a no. So in short, if you answer the first question with a no, you stop the evaluation. You don't have to go any further because that child cannot be eligible for 504 services because of a disability. If the answer to the first question is yes, but then the answer to the second question is no, then you stop. You don't have to answer the third question because that child cannot be eligible for a disability under Section 504. If you answer question one yes, question two yes, you will go on to three. But if that answer is no, the child cannot meet the eligibility requirements. So it doesn't matter which question is a no. It just takes one no to make that child ineligible. Now, unlike special education, Section 504 does not provide for a free independent education evaluation. Of course, you can certainly have a private evaluation done, but it would be at your own expense. If you choose to do that, share the findings with the school district, and they are obligated by law to consider that evaluation, but just like in the IEE, they are under no obligation to accept its findings or recommendations. Remember what we said about the IEE with special ed? The district can reject it all, they can accept it all, or they can pick and choose what they're going to accept and reject. Now, there are many IEP members who are required to attend an IEP meeting. The first is the administrator or his or her designee. This person is responsible to ensure that the supports and services provided for in the IEP will be available, and lack of funding is not used as an excuse to provide them. The general education teacher is the one who should be familiar with your child and who has knowledge of the grade level curriculum your child will be expected to learn. And then the special education teacher will be able to explain to you how the lessons in the general education classroom will be accommodated and how those accommodations will be documented and reported to you. The parent must be invited. And now while an IEPT meeting can be held without the parent, it can only be done so when accompanied by repeated documented attempts on the part of the school to schedule the meeting at a time that works for all parties involved. Repeated no-shows to an agreed upon scheduled meeting or failure to respond to request to schedule a meeting are all good reasons for an IEP meeting to proceed without the parent. But if the school waits too long to begin the scheduling process and the IEP will go out of timelines if you can't make it at the only time they're offering, that is not sufficient reason to proceed without the parent. Now, the student can attend if the parent so desires, but if the student has turned 18, it's important to know that all rights have been transferred to that adult now student, and that the parent can only attend if the adult student agrees. So it's very important when they're talking about transition from the time the child was 16 on, that you get information, and typically it's when the child turns 17, they'll do it. But you need to have information about what your options are as a parent if for some reason you don't think your child is able to negotiate those rights that'll be transferred to them. Now, other people might be present at the IEP meeting. Related services personnel, like an occupational therapist, a physical therapist, speech therapist, counselors, or nurses may also be determined necessary. If that's the case, then these support personnel should also be in attendance. Others may attend the IEP at the request of the parent or the school. Any additional people present should know the child and be able to contribute to the discussion. This could include family members, advocates, or attorneys. Now, if you want to bring an advocate and an attorney, it would be appropriate to inform the school at the time the meeting is scheduled. Usually when a parent brings an attorney, the school will want their attorney present as well. But so informing the school in advance will often save you the inconvenience of showing up with an attorney and then the school rescheduling because they didn't know you were going to bring yours and they can't get in touch with theirs this quickly to have them present. So that is going to be a problem. If you want to bring an advocate, you don't have to notify the school in advance, but doing so will often make the meeting less contentious. If you want to bring a family friend, a relative, or anyone else for moral support, there's no need to inform the school, although you certainly may if you choose. I will say this, however, I always encourage you to let the school know who is going to be present, or at least how many people will be present, because you want to make sure that there's a room large enough for all of the participants. You know what it's like when you walk in, there might be 10 people to the school system. If you bring five, they might have a room scheduled for big enough for 10 or 11, but not the 15 or 16. So it's just a matter of making sure that y'all are comfortable during the meeting. But remember, while you don't have to inform the school of everyone you might be bringing with you, the school must inform you of all their representatives prior to the day of the meeting. The IEP team is responsible to collect and review data related to the concerns of the parent and or the school. These concerns might involve academics, behavior, medical, or other areas. The person in charge of the IEP team, usually but not always the special education teacher, then coordinates a date and time that is appropriate for all team members to meet in order to discuss these data. It is during the IEP meeting that these data are reviewed and discussed as they pertain to the student's disability, as well as the progress the student is making or is not making. If insufficient progress is being made, then the team should consider changing some of the goals and objectives and or accommodations or supports being provided. Based on the decisions, discussions of the progress, the IEP team should indicate when they will meet next to review the progress again. It doesn't have to be a specific date. Like you don't say, we're going to meet again on March 14. What you can say is we're looking at the data. We want to look at it for a few weeks. So we'll meet again in 6 weeks, or we'll meet again in 9 weeks, or we'll meet again in 3 weeks, depending on what the circumstance is. So you want to make sure, though, that an agreement is made as to how long it will be before the next meeting. And it might be, based on the discussion of the progress, you might not need to meet until the annual IEP. That's an individualized decision that you can make during that meeting. Now, the decisions made during the IEP meetings are how the IEP team is defining FAPE for the student. FAPE is the destination. The IEP meeting is sort of like the roadmap to get to it. During these discussions, it's important to remember that FAPE stands for Free Appropriate Public Education, as we said, and not free optimal public education. So some of the things that are discussed may be great, but they may exceed the scope of appropriate. If that's the case, remember the school is legally obligated to provide appropriate, not optimal. And if you're asking for something that is perhaps will be determined optimal, always tell the school what it is you hope to accomplish by that, because there may be other ways for them to meet those needs and to get to that same point that you want to get to. But at the very least, it's worthy of a discussion. Now, remember that one of the differences between special education eligibility and 504 eligibility is that in 504, if the answer to all three of these questions is yes, the student has a disability as defined by Section 504, and that disability substantially limits one or more of the major life functions, then that student is determined to have a disability and is eligible for services. But with special education or IDEA, the IDEA requires that the evaluation go one step farther. Once it is determined that a child has a disability, in order to be eligible to receive special education services, he or she must also demonstrate a need for specialized instruction in order that he be able to have equal access to the general education curriculum, as do his peers with no disability. If there is no need for specialized instruction, there is no eligibility for special education. The role of the SPLC on the 504 team is pretty much the same as the role of the IEP team. The required members are the same, as are their functions. The same rules and suggestions apply for a 504 meeting as they do for an IEP meeting. The purpose is to discuss data and make decisions. You have to be informed of the people present representing the school, and you should, in my opinion, inform the school of those you will bring with you, but you are, again, not required to do so. The SPLC, or 504 team, once the student is determined eligible, has the same purpose and functions about the same as the IEP team for students receiving special education services. Remember, just because your child is receiving services due to eligibility under Section 504 regulations, that doesn't mean that the team doesn't need to go through all of the steps. They should have current data available. Take the time to discuss those data, obtain your feedback and concerns, and make decisions. If you are told, as I've seen happen repeatedly, that you only have 10 or 15 minutes for this meeting, you may either ask them to reschedule on another day for a longer period of time, or take the time, 10 or 15 minutes that they're giving you, and when you're out of time, tell them that you want to continue the meeting and set the date before you leave. If you're not given enough time to discuss your concerns or review the data, then your right to meaningfully participate is being violated. As the discussion about accommodations takes place, data should be present during the meeting in order to support whatever decisions are made by either the IEP or 504 teams. This prevents the discussion from centering on the wrong people. It's not about what the school wants to provide, what the school feels they're able to provide, or honestly, what the parent wants provided. There must be data to justify each decision regarding accommodations, because it is what the child requires based on the evaluation and the data that are being presented. For example, a student who's reading three grade levels below his expected reading level, like a sixth grader reading at the third grade level, might well qualify for test read aloud. Whereas a student who is reading on or near grade level would probably not qualify for this accommodation. All parties need to recognize the harm that can be done to a student who's not receiving the needed accommodations, as well as the harm that can come to a student who's receiving more accommodations than needed. You want to level the playing field. It's not about giving someone an advantage, it's about leveling the playing field, which means that children without disabilities and children with disabilities have the same opportunity for success because of those accommodations. And quite honestly, if you over-accommodate, then you're giving the child a crutch, if you will, that they will not have throughout their educational career and they will not have throughout life. So you want to make sure it's just what they need in order to level the playing field. For example, you wouldn't provide a wheelchair for an ambulatory student with a learning disability any more than you would provide a calculator to a student who has no math computation deficits. Now, while IDEA eligibility is important, determined by the student's need for specialized instruction, remember that Section 504 has no such eligibility requirements. Therefore, it's very possible that a student may meet 504 eligibility requirements and an IAP is written which has no accommodations listed. So you might ask, so then what's the point of a 504 plan? And the answer is simple. First of all, as a student who meets the definition of a student with a disability under 504 regulations, your child will enjoy the protection of Section 504 when it comes to disciplinary infractions. Additionally, should the identified disability begin to create problems for your child, he or she is already eligible for 504 services, so it would only take a 504 meeting to add needed accommodations based on the new needs. This will prevent a critical loss of time between the identification of the need and the school's ability to address it. And as we've already discussed, accommodations are determined based on student needs and data to support those needs. However, not all accommodations can be made available to students. We've already discussed how accommodations need to match the needs of the student with data and should be geared toward leveling the playing field so that your child will have an equal opportunity to access the general ed curriculum and the school programs as his or her peers who don't have disabilities. But there are some accommodations that cannot be provided. That list would include any accommodation that is not allowed on the LEAD test. For example, there are many parts of the statewide standardized test LEAD which measure reading comprehension. On any part measuring reading comprehension, test read aloud cannot be an accommodation for any child, regardless of their disability. All other parts of the test may be read aloud to students who have that as an accommodation, just not the part measuring reading comprehension. Now, once the IEP or IAP team determines which accommodations are to be provided, it is then the responsibility of the school personnel to provide those accommodations and to document the provision and effectiveness of those accommodations. You should ask the team how the provision and effectiveness of these accommodations will be documented and how that document will be shared with you. This could include charts, graphs, whatever means they use to keep track of the progress of the child and the implementation of the accommodations. It could also be, you also want to ask for a timeline. So you're going to get, they tell you you're going to get a chart. They keep a chart for the student. Well, great, how often will I get a copy of that chart? Will it be daily, monthly, weekly, quarterly? Come up with a decision and have it included in the 504 plan or in the IEP so that it becomes part of the record and part of the FAPE, because that will become part of FAPE, so you know when you're going to get this. Because if you don't know the data, you don't know how the child is progressing, it's hard for you to meaningfully participate in calling another meeting, attending the meeting, and knowing what the data are. And also, as only appropriate accommodations and supports are to be included in the IAP or the IEP, no related services that the child isn't eligible for should be included. So if a child isn't eligible to receive speech, it shouldn't be in the 504 plan or the IEP. They're not eligible for physical therapy, you can put that in the IEP or the IAP. So make sure only related services that the child is eligible for would be included. Now, once the initial evaluation is completed, a reevaluation must be conducted at least every 3 years. If you and the school determine that one is needed before the 3 years are up, an IEP meeting can be convened to discuss the concerns and determine whether or not an evaluation should be conducted prior to the 3-year anniversary date. It should be noted that the school system does not have to agree to a reevaluation until at least one full year has passed since the completion of the most recent evaluation. But also, let me make sure, if it's been more than a year since the evaluation, even if it's been less than a year, if you don't agree with the findings a year later, 2 years later, and the school doesn't want to do another re-eval, that's fine. Just ask for an independent education evaluation if you haven't already had one. That way you get the evaluation, it gives you new data, and then y'all can move forward from there, as we discussed earlier. Now, if the school is doing the triennial every 3-year re-evaluation, what is that supposed to look like? It should look a lot like the initial evaluation. The evaluation team should consist of the necessary members and disciplines so that the areas of concern are all able to be addressed. New assessment information should be obtained. When it is time for the reevaluation, when that time comes up, you might be asked to sign a waiver. My recommendation, and I did not allow this when I was working in a school system as a special ed director, but my recommendation is that you do not allow a waiver to take place. Always expect that a full reevaluation will be conducted. Some school districts do a really good job with the waiver. They do it in such a way that it's conducive to reliable and current results. They review a lot of data that have been obtained since the last evaluation was done, including work samples, et cetera. But there are far too many districts who will just, for the most part, use the same data that was available for the most recent evaluation. And that's going back to provide current information, which will help to revise the IEP in order to obtain better results for the student. That doesn't work. So because if they're allowed to do a waiver evaluation and they do it the quick way, by the time that it's time for yet another evaluation, the data, which are all instructional decisions are being made, are in effect 6 years old. So if your child is evaluated in second grade and you grant a waiver for a reevaluation due when he's in fifth grade, by the time that reevaluation is due when he gets to eighth grade, your eighth grader IEP has accommodations and supports that are most, for the most part, based on your child's second grade data. Think about how much a child grows between second and eighth grade. It's just not effective. And while it is allowed in law, it is not mandated. So again, my suggestion, never let anybody do a waiver. Make sure that you get new testing, new data, and those new data are discussed during the meeting to determine continuing eligibility. Now, while the process, the evaluation process for 504 is much less structured than the evaluation process for special ed, everything else is the same. A reevaluation should take place at least every 3 years, should include the administration of new assessments, and should include academic, attendance, behavioral, and social data that are current. A Section 504 reevaluation conducted properly is important for the same reasons we discussed for special education evaluations. Now we've talked about some of your rights for an independent education evaluation, some of those things. Parents' rights information is required to be provided to the parents at least once per school year. This is true whether your child is eligible for special ed or for Section 504 services. It's important that the school provides these rights at least annually because it's the law. But it's important to you because if you experience any kinds of problems, you will always have a current copy of your rights to which you may refer. Now, I know, and I said this when I was a parent, when my children were in school. I know I have enough parent rights to wallpaper a big room. So what I would suggest is don't do like I do. Don't just keep them all. You get one today, throw away the one you got last year. And because a lot of times, like in the parish that I worked in, we gave one in every IEP meeting and pretty much at every 504 meeting. So when I get one today, I'm going to throw the one we got, whether the last IEP meeting or 504 meeting was a year ago or a month ago. I throw that one away. And the reason you want to do this is because you want to have the most current rights. And sometimes the rights are changed at the state level and districts aren't even informed of. So you want to make sure you have what you need to make sure that you can access all of your rights in a way that you're entitled to. What are your rights under IDEA? This is the list of your rights under this is the list of the primary rights under IDEA. You have a right to see your child's school records. You have a right to ask that your child be reevaluated. You have a right to request an IEE, independent education evaluation. You have a right to have the opportunity to meaningfully participate in all IEP meetings and decisions. You have a right to seek mediation. You have a right to request a hearing. You have a right to get regular reports of your child's progress, and you have a right to be informed of the rights afforded you under IDEA. What are they with 504? Very similar. It's the same rights that you have, except you do not have the right to mediation. Mediation is not an opportunity that is afforded to parents of 504, nor is the independent education evaluations. Other than that, your rights are all the same. You know, I was a principal for many years, and then I was a special ed director for 11 years, and over 504 for several of those years. And when I was in those roles as special ed director, principals and teachers would always ask me, who does 504 and special ed fix? And they'd be surprised at my answer, because the answer would be nobody. Then I would just pause and continue after a few seconds and watch them light up, because now they know they're right, it's useless. You know, we have to do this, but it's useless. Then I would continue with, because students who are eligible for 504 or special ed are not broken. Then I go on to explain that the purpose of 504 and special ed is merely to level the playing field through accommodations, extra supports, and services. Then many would tread the dark waters and go, that's not fair. And just for the record, and I say this every time I do this presentation because I mean it so much, I hate the statement of that's not fair. I wouldn't let my children use that expression to explain anything in life, and they both have disabilities. So I say this, Being the warm, wonderful, wise man that they all knew I was, I would calmly say, okay, so let's talk about fair. I would think that a child in a wheelchair might think it isn't fair that he can't walk. I would think that a child who struggles just to be able to read letters and numbers might think it's not fair that they can't read as well as their friends and peers. Well, you know what? That's not fair. Section 504 provides teachers and administrators the ability to level the playing field so that a child's disability doesn't inhibit his or her ability to a point that opportunities for a child with a disability are fewer than for those with children, for children without a disability. Is it unfair that a child in a wheelchair uses an elevator to get to the second floor? Obviously not. So why is it unfair for a student who struggles to read to get some extended time to complete assignments? The short answer is it's not unfair. That you don't like it doesn't make it wrong. That you don't like it doesn't make it unfair. That you don't like it doesn't change the fact that it's a law. I also have to explain some of the to the really stubborn ones that we don't all have to agree with the law, but we do have to follow the law. And we must also remember that none of this is about what's fair, it's about what's legal. And in my opinion, about what's right, but I'm very careful about who I argue that with because not everybody thinks right is the same. Now, in 2014, the Louisiana legislature passed Act 833, which has since been renamed the April Dunn Act. This act allows certain students with disabilities to earn a high school diploma, whereas before they weren't able to. The IEP teams discuss the student's needs and determines how the student can meet the graduation requirements. The standards aren't changed. In other words, they're learning all the same thing. But the way that the student demonstrates mastery of the required standards can be very different for the Act 833 students than it is for those students who do not meet the requirements set forth with the Act. The April Dunn Act applies only to certain students who are receiving special education services, so it does not apply to Section 504 students. And one of the main benefit of this is children with disabilities who have the cognitive ability to be able to meet the general education criteria for graduation are able to graduate now. Before, children of average or above average intelligence, but they had maybe a reading or a writing disability, they weren't able to master the way that teachers wanted them to demonstrate mastery. That has been overcome with, that has been changed. It gives them an equal opportunity to graduate. Now, what that the main outcome is it gives kids a fair shot at attaining what kids without a disability can attain. Still have to do the same work. But I'm not gonna say it's unintended, but from the State Department, it might be unintended consequence. The reality of another consequence though, is that now in Louisiana, we don't rate on the bottom for students with disabilities graduation. Our kids are still doing the same curriculum, but more of them are graduating. So we have moved up on that list. And that's important because people look at students, if you have a disability, are you gonna move to a state where they have 50th in the ranking of how many kids graduate if they have a disability? We've moved it up. We've made Louisiana more attractive for students with disabilities and their families so that we know we're not watering down the criteria. We're merely giving another way for students to meet those criteria. So then the question we started off with, Congress, which is better, Section 504 or 1508? Well, the short answer to that question of which is better is neither. They're different and apply to different students with differing levels of need. One suggestion that I'm going to give, while neither special education nor 504 is better than the other, the special education evaluation process, in my humble opinion, is much more thorough because it has to be by law. Also by law, the evaluation for 504 eligibility really can't be as structured as the process used for special education. So I always suggest to parents, initially when you have concerns and want an evaluation, be very specific that you want your child evaluated for special education regardless of your concerns. The reason I say this, and I will tell you, when I was special ed director, I was not well loved because of this by the school people. But the reason I say this is that a wider array of assessments will be administered by professionals who are trained in assessment practices. More data will be collected, and that will provide more data to the school when trying to determine FAPE. Worst case scenario, your child won't be eligible for special education services, but they might be eligible for 504 services. If she's eligible for Section 504, the 504 team will have much more in-depth data to use when making a plan to assist your child. And even if your child isn't eligible for either, there will be recommendations within the evaluation report for a special ed report that will assist the general ed teacher in addressing your concerns in the classroom for your child. It is win, win, win. Yes, it costs a little, it costs more to have a special ed evaluation, not for you, but for the school system, because they're talking about people that have higher degrees, have higher training levels, and that's okay, because the goal is not to save the school district money or to cost them more. It's to make sure we have the best information for your child and for your child's teachers. And then remember too, if you have a child that has autism, you have a private, a medical diagnosis of autism, you want them to do a special ed evaluation for autism, and this is true for any disability. But it's, there are many kids who are diagnosed with autism through the medical community who will not meet special ed criteria for one reason. They meet the criteria for autism, except they don't need any specialized instruction or support. That's why all school systems have children who have medical diagnosis, diagnoses of autism, and they're not eligible for special ed. Well, you've got the medical diagnosis, you know now that the child is not eligible for special ed, but they have all kinds of information in that evaluation. When you go to 504, that medical diagnosis will make your child eligible for 504 services. And now your teacher is going to be able to have all this information that you need. And on a much more practical point from the school system, and again, I hope from yours, the teachers do the 504 evaluations usually. In many districts, they do it. Well, teachers, you read about it all the time. They have more kids in their classroom than they ever did before. They have less planning time than they ever did before. Yada, 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 yada. You've got all those things going for you. So do you think that they're going to be a little bit more rushed to do that evaluation when they're not as trained to do assessments as diagnosticians, social workers, school psychologists? Yes, it's going to take them longer to do that evaluation to get more information, and I think more reliable information. That's my opinion. So that's pretty much the differences between 504 and special ed. It's a lot. It is a lot. But I do want to remind you, I'm not a lawyer, so if you have legal questions, if you call us and ask us a question and it's a legal question, we'll tell you. But you can ask us first, and we'll let you know if we can answer it or if we can't. So just remember that we're not lawyers. We're just here to be able to help generate some questions, hopefully. All right. Does anyone have any questions right now? I don't see anything in the chat box. Does anyone have any questions? If you do, you can raise your hand and we'll try to answer that. And look, I know I'm from South Louisiana, so typically I speak fast. If I spoke too fast, I apologize. But just do know, this is something that means a lot to me as much as it does to you. Because quite honestly, when my children were in school, very little of this, 504 wasn't a factor. They were both eligible for special education, but the services provided back in the early 80s was nowhere near what the options are now. So what I'm going to ask you to do is, and if you want this presentation, let us know and send it to you. But here's the contact information, write it down. Kylie Grzappi is the education liaison. I'm the director, but Kylie Grzappi is our education liaison with Bioland Families Helping Families. There's your email, there's your phone number. Wallace Johnson, who you had the pleasure of meeting and listening to at the beginning of the presentation, he works with the Families Helping Families of Southwest Louisiana. He's a fountain of knowledge, as are many of the other employees at Southwest Louisiana. There's his information. Jot it down or ask us. Okay, I see a question that says, it looks like dyslexia would fall under special education. Is that correct? Not necessarily. If you notice, when we listed the 13, it did not list dyslexia. However, if you have a child that has a diagnosis of dyslexia, you would request that they have a special education evaluation for a specific learning disability, because there are criteria that overlap with dyslexia and specific learning disability. Some students with dyslexia qualify under SLD, specific learning disability, some do not. However, if they qualify under special education for SLD, they will get an IEP. If they don't, get them to 504, determine that eligibility, which would be yes in all likelihood, and then we get accommodations based on that. To be quite honest with you, especially with dyslexia, it doesn't really matter which one they're eligible for. Programming should look the same, regardless of what it is. There's very little under special ed that you can't get under 504. So if you have a child with dyslexia, try for special ed, only because there's more support with special ed. It's not because it's better or worse. There's more support. You have parents that assist with special ed. You have certified special ed teachers. In 504, you have general ed teachers that they do it all. So that's what I would do. It doesn't necessarily, it can, but it doesn't necessarily fall under special education because it's not one of the 13 identified. So Julie, I hope that answers your question. If not, you have our email address. Okay, good. Thank you very much. All right. Anybody else have any other questions? Well, what I want to do, I want to thank you so much for your attention and thank you for your questions. And Wallace, thanks for helping me get this set up and presented at your part of the presentation. You did a great job at the beginning. I learned some things from you every time I listen to you. And Wallace and I look forward to hearing from you whenever you need assistance with your Section 504 or special education journey. It is not an easy journey to undertake alone. That's who we are, and that's what we do. So please let us help you with that. Now, at the end, remember when you log off of this workshop, there's going to be a survey that's going to come on your screen, and it has 7 questions. And remember, it's going to take about 2 minutes or so to complete and submit. If you would do that for us, it helps us to know what changes we need to make, if any, and then we can move forward from there. But I want to thank you again for helping us. Wallace, I want to thank you for presenting. And I hope you all have a terrific day because it looks like it's going to be much better weather than it was yesterday. Y'all have a great day. Thank you for your patience and most importantly for your time.